So let's take a look now at Android 4.4. Let's have a look at some of the things that have changed. Now, with Android 4.4 on a Nexus device, it's free from all of the extras that the main manufacturers like Samsung and HTC load onto their devices. Instead, we get what does Google want from its Android device. So things are very cut down, you get a slim set of Google applications and no extra fluff or bloatware. Now, the first thing to notice is you could almost call it the candification of interfaces. Certainly it feels like it's taken a little bit of a leaf out of the iOS playbook, but what they've gone for here is something that's fully colourful, bright. Part of that is being given by the wallpaper that comes as default, but in part also, if you look at the icons, you'll notice they're a much higher resolution, and there's really nice anti-aliasing going on. You can't see any jagged lines or any edges or anything like that. And the icons have a kind of pop to them that was kind of missing, I think, in the previous versions of default Android, as it were. Overall, everything kind of just feels that little bit more polished and groovy, I think is probably the way to put it. Yes, that's it. Android 4.4 KitKat is groovy looking. You can debate that one if you like in the comments, but I think it's groovy looking. They've also, for instance, a few of these items have been downloaded just as my system's auto backup kicks in and just starts delivering all my apps to me. But they've now added a settings icon within the app tray, which I don't ever remember being there before, or if it was, it had a really ugly looking icon for it. There's now a nice icon that will take you straight into your settings, which obviously if you long press, and you can just drop that wherever you happen to want it to be. Standard Android stuff, there's nothing new there, as it were. There's no pinch mechanism, so if you want to pinch between your home screens, forget it. That's not part of the Android experience when you're looking at the pure Google Android. One of the things that was interesting is they've released a recording tool, which is apparently available for developers. Now, I thought it was actually included as part of Android 4.4 out of the box, but it doesn't appear to be, or at least I can't find it anywhere. Maybe you have to go in and turn that on through developer tools. A lot of the stuff you will know pretty well. You know, it's the Google services, it's Google Plus, it's the Gallery app, it's Drive, it's Chrome. You know, the standard stuff that comes with Android 4.4, unfortunately made a little bit more difficult here by auto backup having kicked in and deciding to drop all of my apps to me. Although on the plus side, at least I'd have to go and download them all again. And so one of the things always worth looking at on a new Nexus device is having a look at how the settings and notification shade area has changed. So one of the main things is they now look quite a bit nicer than they used to, going with this kind of cool black and white vibe, and it feels like it has more pop to it than it used to do. It looked a little mucky before, in my opinion. But then also, if we come into here, we can then get into our settings area. This stuff is pretty much the muchness. I haven't noticed any major changes in here particularly. The only big one is this printing option down at the bottom. That I do not remember being part of previous Android experiences, and was mentioned that it was going to get baked directly into the operating system from here on out. So if you happen to use cloud printing, or if you have any of the Google Cloud Print services available, or the HP Print remote print, then effectively you can print directly from your Android device to any printer that your Google account knows about. Very handy, I must say. So we've got our usual thing, go in and do our Wi-Fi, our Bluetooth. One major change they've made in Android 4.4 is better support for low power Bluetooth devices, things like the Fitbit and so on. If we come into more, we've got our airplane mode, NFC, default SMS app. Now this is new, and this allows you, if you have multiple different short messaging service apps on your device, you can pick which one will be the default app. Fantastic, and about time too. And one thing they've done with Google Hangouts is integrate SMS and Hangouts into one application. So now Hangouts becomes your messaging app. You don't have Hangouts, Google Talk, SMS app, and everything else. You just have one app to do everything. But like I say, for manufacturers, developers, and so on, you can hook into this, and if you have an SMS app, you'll be able to make it the default from now on. That is really, really great news. You can just pick which app you want to use and you're not constantly fighting the notifications all the time. NFC, some changes to the way NFC works, purely from a point of view of making payments. That's one of the big things they've done here. So NFC now has an alternative secure mode, effectively, which makes it work properly with the way that the payment processors and providers wanted it to work. This now should remove a lot of the problems we had with Google Wallet not being compatible with anything on the payment side of things. So it'd be very good to see that hopefully this year. I keep saying it every year, but hopefully this will be the year NFC catches on. Tethering and portable hotspot, your VPN, you're doing your mobile networks, your mobile plan, your mobile broadcasts in there. Now, one of the other new areas is home. Now in here, you can basically set what your launcher is going to be. So that's the default launcher, and I've also got smart launchers just installed as well, pulling from my auto backup. But effectively, you can now set these or delete them as necessary. That is going to make life so much easier for a lot of people, me especially, who uses a lot of different launchers. No more hacking, basically, to make sure your launcher is always used as the default when you hit your back button. In sound, we've got the usual standard kind of stuff. Adjust your volume, choose your ringtone, set up vibrate when ringing, your dial touch and everything like that, lock sounds, touch sounds, which I'm so pleased they turned off by default. Thank you, Google. You have no idea how annoying it is when, because obviously I have to reinstall my device quite often for new ROMs and updates and fiddling around with it. And one of the most annoying things is having to go through the initial setup hearing blip, 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 or blip, blip, blip every time I touch something. So having that turned off by default is fantastic. You can, of course, turn that on if you need to. Why would you? Display. In here, we can adjust our brightness. Use the standard googly brightness slider. Nothing special there. Wallpaper. This is where we can set our Android wallpaper, including the new smart wallpapers. I'm not actually sure about those yet. Live wallpaper is in there, nothing particularly exciting. Gallery, just my photos basically. And obviously wallpapers at the bottom, which includes a couple of new ones by the looks of it. Ooh, yes, very, very nice. Let's have a bit of that, shall we? Oops, do that properly. Hit set wallpaper up at the top, there we go. There's also your sleep timeout and the auto rotate settings. Sleep timeout, this is how long the screen will stay on for before it simply turns itself back off, saving your battery. You've got the daydream, which you can set to pretty much all the stuff you could do before. They haven't really expanded that, unfortunately. So you've got the photo frames. That's one of my apps that's added itself in. Standard colors and the clock, obviously. Set your fonts. Pulse notification light. I always get that one mixed up. Get them the wrong way around. Effectively, whenever you get a message or an alert on your device, it will pulse the notification light, which is somewhere here, I think. Actually, where is it on the Nexus 5? That's a really interesting point. Does it have one? Must have. Well, we will find out where the pulse light is, because actually, I'm not sure it's got one. Which would be interesting. And you've also got access to do the wireless display if you want to, which is known as Miracast, I believe, to give it its technical term. If we come into storage, this is where we can do our space. As you can see, I've only got 9 gig available now, 12 gig overall. This was a 16 gig Nexus 5 model, and obviously a load of my apps have now installed themselves. Interesting to note though, if you got the Galaxy S4, then you actually only got 9 gig of available space because of all of the extra stuff that Samsung had installed. So it's really nice here that a 16 gig device actually had 12.5 gig available for me to install things. Even now when I've installed all of my stuff from the auto backup, I still have nearly as much space as a Samsung would out of the box. Kind of shows you how bloated some of these main manufacturers have become with their operating systems. One thing that we really need to see from Android is more space as default when you take it out of the box, not less, because you're adding more and more useless features. So good on Google for keeping things slim and making sure that, you know, as many gig as possible is free for us. Battery, this is very standard stuff, shows you what's running in your device right now, so what and what's been using up space over the preceding time period. So you can see here my screen is draining 30% of my battery, Android OS 15%, Android system, etc. Very handy way of just seeing what's going on the device and what might be killing your battery. If we go into apps, again, all standard stuff. They've not made many tweaks here, really. I think a lot of it is, everything's gone a bit grey, so we've got the nice black background, grey status bars, etc. But the interface generally hasn't changed that much on the Android 4.4 update. Location, we can turn our location services on or off, and we can also now change how accurate we would like that to be. And it gives a bit more information over 4.3 on what's really going on there. If you drop it into battery saving mode, it will just do Wi-Fi and mobile networks to estimate the location, put it on high, and it'll kick in the GPS as well. You do device only, use GPS to pinpoint the location. So you've got a few choices now as to how you want location to work. And more importantly, thank you Google, it's actually explained properly how that works and how it really relates to saving your battery, etc. Security, it's your screen locks, it's your widgets on the home screen, encrypting your phone, passwords, everything like that. And will you allow unknown sources? Always worth doing, in my opinion. And install from internal storage. Basically, if there's anything security related, you will find it in there. Language and input, this is where your keyboards are kept. As you can see, I've got quite a few, including Google Hindi and Google Pinyin even. Which I definitely have never installed previously, and Google Korea, definitely never installed that one. But presumably that is just defaulted in for us, which is nice. Now, with backup and reset, what they've allowed you to do is to backup absolutely everything into the cloud now, up to Google services. So you can go into there, and it just has your standard options are in there, basically. Date and time, accessibility, and the aforementioned printing tool. But overall, there's not a huge amount of new stuff for Android 4.4 in the settings. A lot of it really is under the hood with Android 4.4. It's the little things that they've done to really tweak it. Much better memory use on low-powered devices with 512 of RAM, new options for the NFC, a few new tweaks here and there, and new stuff for developers. But overall, Android 4.4 probably doesn't offer an awful lot to the average end user. It doesn't suddenly make this the next big phone release or anything like that. What it does do is incrementally update Android, providing newer hardware specifications for things like low power Bluetooth, etc. And all that is really, really welcome anyway. And what it ultimately means is that, you know, the next generation of hardware coming out over the next 12 months will be able to work with all of the latest gadgets, but doing so in a lower power profile as possible. Everything really with Android 4.4 feels a lot of like when they released the first iteration of Butter, which I think was 4.2 or 4.22. And it's almost about, let's tweak this, let's fix this, let's update this. There's no big revolutions here necessarily in Android 4.4, but overall, lots of little tweaks that add up to a very welcome set of changes.